Good morning.
Good morning.
It is wonderful to see all of you here today, and I especially am looking at the choir. It's great to have you folks back. I do want to chastise you a little bit because I saw none of you during this time off. You really took your time away from worship, so ha, 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 not at all. All right, very good. You can complain all you want. Folks, it is so wonderful to have the choir back with us. It really is. We miss them. They had some time off during the summer, but it's great to have them back. And so we have a great music program here. We really do. I'm going to shut up because Jackie doesn't like me talking like that, but we just do. And so it's great to have our choir back. There are some announcements in our bulletin. Friday and Saturday is our rummage sale here. So be sure and get all of your rummage sale items in this week because they are needed. I also want to mention to you that August the 13th is our startup date again for the Time for Young Disciples. The Time for Young Disciples took a break during the summer because our kids were on break, and so we are beginning up again. For those of you who don't know, after the Time for Young Disciples, we have children's church after the Time for Young Disciples, where kids can go and be in children's church over in our educational wing. I also want to mention to you that First Sunday collection for sharing and caring is today. Barbara must be in the back. We've got Barbara, do we have a pail back there, or what do we have for
Sunday.
Next Sunday.
Silver Sunday,
but today is Sharing and Caring Sunday, okay? Very good, okay? And so all donations help families in need for sharing and caring. All right, the other thing I want to mention to you is that our cookie bakers are going back to work in the kitchen. Well, not going back, but they are looking for help starting August the 16th and each Wednesday from 12:30 to 3 p.m. Usually we see Chris Rollins and Sharon Land over there. If you would like to join them, I know they would like to have you with them. I'm looking at our announcements here. We do have Presbyterian Women Luncheon on Tuesday, August the 15th at 11:30 a.m. That's going to be at Pepper's Mexican Restaurant over on Mary Esther. They're looking also to have the Dirty Labor Day gift exchange, and please bring $15, and they always have fun. So I know our women, those who are able, will love to be there. School is starting up again this week, and our teachers and secretaries are already back in, and so we give thanks for them today, and always pray for them, because their responsibility is huge with our children. So that is happening also. I'm looking here and I don't see anything else. I think I've hit it all. I've got the thumbs up from our guys in the back. So we are good there. All right. If you would, let's bow our heads for the opening prayer today. Your mighty power is always with us, O God. And yet we live as if we were alone. Let this be the hour in which we remember your presence. Change us from a crowd of separate and lonely individuals who experience their own ways into a united people who are seeking your way. And let your love and forgiveness overcome all our doubts, all our anxieties, all our sin. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Standing on holy ground.
As you are able, would you please stand for the call to worship? We come carrying just what we need for the journey.
5 loaves, 2 fish.
We come bringing whatever we have to offer.
Our time, our talents, our gifts.
We come knowing God will multiply our offerings.
In God's hands, what we have is enough.
Let us worship God together.
When we call upon God, God answers. Even when our steps stray from God's path, even when our feet slip, God listens to us and answers our prayers. Let us offer our prayer of confession as we pray together, as our prayer of confession as printed in our bulletins, followed by a moment of quiet meditation. Generous God,
you freely offer us all we need. You offer us the bread of life, so we may never be hungry again. You offer us living water, so we never thirst. But we scoff at your gifts, wasting our money, time, and energy on things that do not satisfy. Forgive us and call to us again, reminding us of your gifts of new life, that are ours if we would only accept them. Amen.
Amen. Let us now incline our ears and listen. God makes an everlasting covenant with us. God forgives us. God renews us. God refreshes us. And God leads us onward. Thanks be to God. Seated.
Let us pray. O God, source of all light, by your word you give light to the soul. Pour out upon us the spirit of wisdom and understanding, that being taught by you in Holy Scripture, our hearts and minds may be open to know the things that pertain to life and holiness. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first scripture reading this morning is from Psalms 119, verses 1 through 8. You may find this in your Pew Bible in the Old Testament on page 566. Listen now once more for God's word. Happy are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Happy are those who keep his decrees, who seek him with their whole heart, who also do no wrong, but walk in his ways. You have commanded your precepts to be kept diligently. Oh, that my ways may be steadfast in keeping your statutes. Then I shall not be put to shame, having my eyes fixed on all your commandments. I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your righteous ordinances. I will observe your statutes. Do not utterly forsake me. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our scripture lesson comes from the book of 1 Corinthians in your New Testament, chapter 3, verse 7. If you would like to follow along with me, I invite you to do that. It is on page number 167 of the New Testament. Listen now for the voice of God in Holy Scripture. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
On this Communion Sunday, the Apostle Paul might begin by saying this: I'd like to recognize the presence of the revered clergy, ha ha ha, the esteemed elders, the organist, the pianist, and the outstanding choir. I would like to recognize all the honored members of the congregation and all other gardeners. All other gardeners. Yes, I said gardeners. Because Paul, in our text, makes it clear that we are all working in the same field. We all have the same status in the presence of the Lord. We are gardeners. We are working in the same field for the same master. All of us have the same footing. All of us have been charged with the same responsibilities. All of us are equally called to our duties. Paul here is especially eager that each one of us realize that we are called to be servants of the one master. He wrote to another church in the book of Romans, and he said this: I say to everyone among you not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. It was important to Paul that all Christians know who they are and how they stand with each other. Now, the Apostle Paul established the church in Corinth, and it had gotten off to a very good start. But somewhere along the way, jealousy and strife began to appear. Now, churches, as you well know, have personalities too, just as individual people do. Some churches are loving and kind. Some churches are boisterous and loud. Some churches are passive and quiet. Some churches are servants. Some churches behave like royalty. And some churches are not happy unless there is conflict. And so what's happening here is that the Corinthian church was developing into a cantankerous, bickering, suspicious group of people who were undermining the leadership of that church. Some were defending Paul as if he were the real leader of the church. Some were defending Apollos against Paul as if he were the real leader of the church. What's happening here is that few seem to be defending Jesus Christ as the head and the leader of the church. I can just hear the members of the Corinthians saying, "Jesus who?" They were intent on fighting. They were babes in Christ whose most prominent characteristics, according to the Bible, were envy, strife, and an ability to separate themselves into hostile divisions. Let me step back and give you a bit of information about my own background and how this passage impacts me and has impacted my story and is part of my story. In 2001, I resigned as senior pastor of First Presbyterian Church in Greenville, North Carolina, quite honestly, because I was burned out. I was the only pastor in a church of 1,200 members. I was very foolish to take it on, and what happened is after 6 years, I just burned out. And so the folks that I worked with who deal with clergy burnout said, John, you can do one of two things or one of however many things. You can stay in the church, but you've got to do something else. You just can't, you can't be pastor. You just can't. You're burned. You're toast. You're crisp. Or you can do something else, secular work, anything you want to do, but you can't do this any longer for however knows who long. It's just, you can't take it. You can't do it anymore. And so what happened was, I have a sister who's a State Farm agent, and so she had told me before when she'd come to Greenville and watched what was going on, she told me, she says, John, I'm concerned because from what I can see, you're killing yourself. You are just so wrapped up in this, and all you do is work, and you may need to do something different. Little did she know that I was having these conversations with folks about what I would do next. And so what did happen was I moved to Denver, Colorado, and in moving to Denver, I became a member of Denver Presbytery, but I did nothing in terms of ministry. And what I did was I was trying to discern where God was leading me next because I really did not know. I felt God's leadership in going to Denver and doing another job, but my question was, dear God, will I ever be back in the church again? I just don't know. Well, what happened was one Saturday morning, I got a call, and my wife came into the bathroom, and I was taking a shower, and she said, John, there is someone from some church wanting to talk with you. And I said, that would be fine. Do you think they'll hold? I'd rather go ahead and take this now. And she said, I think they will. And so they held for me, and I went down, and I got on the phone, and this is when we had landlines, folks, to show you. This was like 2001. And so I went down, I got on the landline, and this person said, hi, this is Bart Mossberger, and I wanted to see if you could come and preach this Sunday morning for us. And I said, well, maybe this is the answer I'm looking for. I didn't know. 4 years, I had not led worship or preached in 4 years. I had gone to church, but I had not preached or led worship. And so I made arrangements to go ahead and go to the Byers Community Church. Now, you need to understand that what happens in Colorado a lot is that Presbyterian churches, part of their history, is that they are trying to make themselves more palatable to the community because people don't understand what Presbyterian is. And so Byers Presbyterian Church had become Byers Community Church so that they would become more palatable to the community at large. And so I went out to Byers that morning, and you got to understand a little bit about Byers here. Byers is about 50 miles from Denver, 50 miles east of Denver. And if you've never been to Denver or that part of the country, what happens is if you come from the east, coming into Denver, basically it all looks like Kansas. Very flat. Not many trees. And so Byers was on what's called the High Plains of Colorado. Looked just like Kansas. Part of what I found out when I walked in was I looked very much out of place because everybody had on cowboy boots. And here I was I didn't wear a three-piece suit or anything, but I looked very much out of place. And so what happened was I walked in, and it was obvious that something had happened there because you could just feel the tension. And so I looked up there, and the communion table, there were a lot of things missing. The cross was not there. There was no symbols of bread or juice or anything there. And I looked at Bart, and I said, Bart, are you guys okay? And Bart said, John, we had a falling out this past Sunday. And the folks who donated and gave the communion ware and the cross and everything else, they were part of the conflict, and they took it all back home. they took it away. And I thought, my Lord, what have I gotten myself into?
That's right.
And so I said, that's okay. It's not a communion Sunday. And so I went ahead and I led worship and I greeted everybody after worship. And, you know, and, but again, there was this tension in the air. Well, now, the next Sunday was communion Sunday. And so Bart was able to make a few calls and able to get at least some rudimentary communion service on the table for that Sunday. And so I went, and so they, when I left that first Sunday and I was at the door, they just said, "What are you doing next Sunday?" And I said, "Nothing that I know of." And so they said, "Would you come back?" And I said, "I would be happy to come back." And so let me tell you briefly, the first Sunday I led worship after four Sundays, I was just so nervous. It had been so long. And honestly, my prayer when they called me before was, "Lord, I don't know when I'm going to be coming back. You know that, but I don't." And so I went back for the second Sunday. It was a communion Sunday. And so what happened, we had some of the rudimentary parts of the communion service there. They had still not brought back all their stuff, but we went ahead and went with it. And then what happened, Marinelle came with me that second Sunday. And I said, I'd like to get your impressions of this church, sweetie. It will help me if you kind of see, you know, if you see what's going on, and we can bounce what's going on off of each other. And so she went with me, and she was sitting not the very last pew, but the next to last pew. And what I found out later was one of the persons who had led the split in the church was sitting behind her, and her name was Peggy. And so what happened was while I was leading worship, Marinelle was sitting there, and Marinelle, and I could hear it, folks, quite honestly, Peggy had a running dialogue the whole service, or a monologue the whole service, about what I was doing and whether it was right or whether it was wrong or what was going on. And I could hear her. I couldn't hear exactly what she was saying, but by the look on Marinelle's face, I knew something was going on. I did hear, though, when I got to communion and I started communion, doing my part of communion, I heard her say in a loud voice, "He's doing it all wrong." And so I kept on going. I just kept on going. And so as I began to, and then after the second Sunday, I walked to the door greeting everybody. Bart comes up to me and he says, "What are you doing next Sunday?" And I said, "Well, if y'all have me back, I'd love to come." And he said, "We'd love to have you." So what happened was, is this relationship began with the church, and I began to find out more about the split. And as I found out more about the split and I talked to Denver Presbytery, they asked me, they said, "Would you be interested in going out there on a regular basis?" And I said, "I will try," because I really didn't know if this was going to work for me and for them. And so I did start going out there, and I found out what had happened. And then after I found out what had happened, I began to go and see people. And once I began to see people, everybody had their story about what was going on. And what happened, there were probably about 70 members of this church. And what happened was, I got Denver Presbytery's permission to do this in terms of saying, "Is this okay?" But basically, I went and heard everybody's story about the church. The good, the bad, the ugly. But the one thing I made sure I did wherever I went, and I did that on Sundays too, is I wore my bootcut jeans and I wore my cowboy boots. And so I went to see everybody in the church. And folks, I heard it all. And it was a mess, quite honestly. You know, they tell you when you look at conflict in a church, they ask you to look at it between what's the scale of the conflict. And usually it's either scaled between 1 and usually 1 and 10. And this was definitely a 10. I told them when I went there, I said, first of all, I want to let you know, you can't make any obscene gestures to each other because it had got to that point. And I said, the other thing is, I said, I just need to point this out. Nobody brings a gun to church, okay? Nobody brings a gun because this was a gun culture, quite honestly. I'm not making a political statement, folks. It just was a gun culture. And so as we began to talk about the church and look at the church over this period of 2 years, we began to find out what had happened, and we also began to resolve some of the conflict. Sometimes, folks, with church conflict, all you can do is bleed it out. You just listen and listen and listen to it. And so what had happened in this church, and why I'm telling you this today, is because these folks were far from fellow gardeners. They were far from fellow gardeners. Now, the result of this conflict, just to go ahead and let you know, was some of the folks just could not stay at the church, and so they left. It was just too much for them. But I had gone to see them. We had tried to resolve it. And at the end, some of them still wanted to fight. And I basically said, I've heard everything. It's time to move on. And so we are fellow gardeners with each other. And as Scripture says, no one is more important than the other. Now, this letter from Paul's first letter was an attempt to call them back to their origins. They must return to their religious roots. They must get rid of their pride and their feelings of self-importance. They needed to know that Paul was nothing, that Apollos was nothing. He was one of the players there. And therefore, they were nothing. Nothing but gardeners working in the field of the Lord. Some were planting, some were watering, some were hoeing, some were weeding, some were pruning, some were cultivating, but they were all gardeners of the owner. The other story I'm going to tell you this morning has to do with Marianelle's family. She is not here this morning because we've had family in this weekend. What happened is her family in eastern North Carolina had a one-acre garden. Now, that is a large garden. It really is. And so, usually, Marianelle and I would go home to her home during the summer, and we would have at least 1 week at the beach where everybody was gathered from that family. Well, what happened was the corn always came off during the summer from the garden. And so, I don't care what you were doing, whether you were at the beach, no matter where you were, what you were doing, when the corn came off, everybody went to the garden, and they harvested the corn. Now, I have to tell you, my father-in-law loved me. I can't tell you how loved I felt by my in-laws. But he was also wary of me because the first time I was doing corn with him, he gave me a very sharp knife. And what happened was I almost cut off my thumb. And so I was not very good at this. And so they would not give me a knife when we were taking off corn, but I had my job, let's just say that. So what Paul is saying here is that no one should think of himself or herself more highly than he or she ought to think. For we are all humble laborers together. Some plant, some water, but it's God who gives the increase here. I want to give you a little bit of Presbyterian history here. John Witherspoon was the only clergy person to sign the Declaration of Independence. He was president of what we now call Princeton University, a man highly regarded in the early history of the nation and of the Presbyterian Church. He was asked to preach at the first meeting of the General Assembly of the Presbyterian Church on May the 21st, 1789. And he was asked to be acting moderator until a permanent one was elected later in the meeting. And he performed the task admirably. He did this as one of the most visible and highly respected people of his day. And he did this even though he had lost his health. He lost the vision in one of his eyes, and he would die within 5 years of the signing of the Declaration of Independence. And so on this occasion, John Witherspoon chose to use the 1 Corinthians 3:7 passage that we're using today. And the passage was also used when he was installed as pastor of the Presbyterian Church of Princeton, New Jersey. And so we know it was a favorite. He used this passage because he wanted the early Presbyterians to know that if they were going to succeed in America, they would have to view themselves as simple gardeners in God's field, tillers of God's earth. They would have to perform faithfully their humble duties in a lowly fashion. They would have to be faithful to those duties and let the increase be in God's hands. And so it was a message then, but it's really a message still today that the Church of Jesus Christ needs to remember this message of John Witherspoon and the Apostle Paul. They are the same. We are today the body of Jesus Christ on this earth. And Jesus Christ was a humble servant. He is always, he must be our model. We are called into Christ's church not to argue, not to criticize, not to complain, but to humbly serve. Someone has said, if you want to fight, join the Marines. If you want to love, join the church. Bonnie Russell has written a very simple poem called Love Loves. Here's what it says. Love is nothing until it loves. Love is nothing until it shares. Jesus himself said, no one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. Friends, this is what Jesus has done for you and what we and millions of others celebrate in the Lord's Supper. This celebration here in front of me, this celebration shows Jesus' great love for us and that we are fellow gardeners together. Together. Let us pray. Now to the one who by the power at work within us is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think. To God be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and forever. Amen. Our affirmation of faith printed in our bulletin is well known to many of you. It is the Apostles' Creed. Let us stand now and say what we believe together using this Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
In love, my vision.
please be seated. We invite you today to profess Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior. We also invite you to unite with us here in membership at First Presbyterian Church. If you are interested in discipleship or in membership, please see me after the service of worship today, or you can call our church office during the week and we will make an appointment to visit with you. As the offertory is played today, let us take a moment to be truly thankful that our gifts may be from the heart and not merely from our checkbook. Let us pray. There is no way, O God, that we can repay you for what you have done for us in Christ Jesus, or what you continue to do for us day by day. Our gifts are but tokens of children to a parent to say, "We love you, God. Amen." Please be seated. joy in all kinds of ways. That may be a smile upon your face. That may be a sense of inner peace and joy for you. But this is the joyful feast of the people of God. And I invite you, as you take this sacrament today, to feel good about what you feel during this time. There are folks who are very quiet during this. Say nothing, think nothing, but are really focused in prayer. But whatever you are feeling today, understand that this is a joyful feast of the people of God. We know that people will come from north and south and east and west and sit at table in the kingdom of God. This is the Lord's table. It's not the table of belong to me, it doesn't belong to our station, our governing body. It is the table of our Lord Jesus Christ. And our Savior invites those who trust in him to share in this great feast that he has prepared for us. According to Luke, when our risen Lord was at table with his disciples, he took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to them. And they recognize. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Let us now pray. In the heat and stillness of this summer morning, O God, we rest. Some of us have carried heavy loads this week. We've had concerns about our health problems. We've had concerns about ourselves or our loved ones. We've had concerns about our finances and how to make things work in an expensive and difficult world. We may have been upset about our relationships with family who don't seem to understand, who seem to give little support. We know you are real, O God. Here in this place, the air is thick with your presence. Our faith assures us not only of your existence, but of your love and your care for us. Confident of this, O God, let us now relax and leave our heavy load bear them with so much more strength. And let the great questions of life find their solution for us in the death of Christ on Calvary and in his resurrection from the grave. For yours is the mystery and the glory forever and ever. And now let us pray the prayer Jesus taught us. Praying together.
Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us today our daily bread.
And forgive us our debts as we forgive
our debtors. And
lead us not into temptation, but deliver
us from evil. For
thine is the kingdom, the power,
and the glory forever. Amen. The Lord Jesus,
on the night of his arrest, took bread,
and after giving thanks to
God, he broke it, and he said,
"This is my body,
broken for you.
Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way,
he took the cup, saying,
This cup is the new covenant
sealed in my blood,
shed for the forgiveness
of sin.
Whenever you drink it, do this
in remembrance of me.
For every time that you eat of this
bread and you drink
of this cup, you proclaim the death
of our Lord until
he comes again.
This is the body of Christ broken for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. Let us pray. Oh God, you have so greatly loved us. You have so long sought us. And you have so long mercifully redeemed us. Give us grace now that in everything we may yield ourselves, our will, and our works annual thank offering to you.
Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
May God, who has fed us at this table with the gift of his divine Son, continue to feed us through this week on the Holy Spirit, that we may be led into every pathway intended for us and possess the joy that has been promised us. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.